Welcome, everybody. While some people are still getting seated, I think we can get started. I'm Manfred Laubichler. I will be the moderator of today's panel on the Anthropocene. I'm an external professor at the Santa Fe Institute and also a professor at Arizona State University. Before I introduce the panel, a few practical announcements are in order. The first, of course, is to thank our sponsors for this evening, which is Thornburg Investment Management, who is supporting the whole range of community events at the SFI, for which we're very grateful. The second sponsor, of course, is the Lenzig Performance Space here, which offers us this beautiful home in the center of Santa Fe, which makes it easy for all of you to get here. You don't have to drive somewhere into the woods. And another sponsor for this particular event is the Arizona State University Santa Fe Institute Joint Research Center for Biosocial Complex Systems. This is an institutional collaboration between ASU and the Santa Fe Institute that actually generates a lot of activities and excitement. Another important thing for you to remember is that this is the second to last community event. There is one more coming on November 7th. There is the final community lecture for the year by Nick Lane, a very fascinating writer and speaker who will talk about how energy shapes the building blocks of life. So this is on November 7th, so mark your calendars for that. Another practical announcement is that we are running an experiment here. This panel has agreed to be interactive with the audience in the following way, not just us talking here for a long time, and then giving you, three or four of you, the opportunity to ask a question. Rather, we have index cards and ushers circling around. So if you have a question while we are talking or want us to definitely change direction because we are going into absolutely the wrong order, write it down. They will find their way here, and I will process them while we are going on, and hopefully we can actually incorporate some of the questions and concerns that you have right into the panel discussion here. As we said, it's an experiment. You don't have to participate that way. If you don't, we might still find some time at the end, but given the fact that we have four Y chromosome carriers on stage, that might not happen. So that's your chance to actually get into the act here. Okay, so let me briefly introduce the panel here. Our first panelist here probably doesn't need much of an introduction in Santa Fe, Geoffrey West, former president of the Santa Fe Institute, distinguished professor at the Santa Fe Institute right now. This is a Santa Fe Institute event. Even though we are talking about the Anthropocene, we have to have a physicist. So that's Jeff. And if you have to have a physicist, you might as well have one who actually just wrote a book that addresses all the concerns that we are dealing with here. And so we have Geoffrey here. Welcome, Geoffrey. Our second panelist, also a long time connected to the Santa Fe Institute, is my dear colleague, Sander van der Leeuw. From Arizona State University, as well as the Santa Fe Institute. Sander is by training an archaeologist, an anthropologist, but has worked for many decades on questions related to sustainability and the role of complex systems in understanding not only the past, but also our present predicament and the future. If you read up on him, you also note that he has been named, a UN champion of the Earth, now I remember. So he certifiably cares about this planet.
That is true.
Welcome, Sam. And then we have done something creative, in particular to slightly decrease the average age on stage. We invited D exclamation point A exclamation point Wallach. DA is many things, despite that he is basically an embryo. He went to Harvard as a Yale man, we can forgive him that, but where he was one of the most creative undergrads, working with Henry Louis Gates, becoming a singer and beginning to dabble in finance. He then had a career as a musician and as a, he says he checked it off his bucket list, acting in a multiple Oscar-winning movie, La La Land, moved gradually from music to investing in the future. That means finding and using his talents and sitting at the pulse of our culture, investing in various companies that might actually shape the future. And so we hope that he offers that perspective today. So welcome, DA. So the focus and the title of this panel is The Past, Present, and Future of the Anthropocene. So maybe a quick show of hand, how many of you think you know what the Anthropocene is? Okay, we can go home. The Anthropocene obviously is a very interesting cultural scientific phenomenon. And it also represents a crucial transformation in our Earth's history. So you all are familiar that our civilization or our culture is a product of the Holocene. The Swiss writer Max Frisch entitled a whole novel, Man in the Holocene. And the subject of this novel basically was, if you think about when we arrived on the stage of this planet compared to the long history of this planet, it's rather insignificant. And so the subject of this novel basically was looking at us in the context of this large history and this vast universe. Now, that insignificant species that appeared in the Holocene has now created what we call the Anthropocene, the age of mankind. And what that entails is that, in general, one species, us, has become the major geological, biochemical, climate-shaping force on this planet, so that we now are actively debating that we have entered a new geological age. What do we mean by that? The term Anthropocene in the modern sense was first introduced by Nobel laureate Paul Crutzen in 2000 in an interestingly entitled essay, The Geology of Mankind. And Crutzen, as you might know, is a chemist who is most famous for discovering the existence as well as the solution to fix the ozone hole. So it was all about chemistry and about our influence on the climate that triggered the initial debate on the Anthropocene. In the years after Crutzen's introduction of that term, it spread like wildfire. It moved out from its initial focus in ecology and climatology and rapidly became the subject of discussion across a whole range of scientific disciplines. Now, that obvious phenomena led to some action on part of some very deliberative scientific bodies. So the geological union, or the geophysical union, those are the guys who are responsible for codifying geological epochs. They set up a commission. And if you know how scientific committees and commissions work, it will come as no surprise that even though they made a recommendation to recognize the Anthropocene as a geological epoch, we haven't set on a date yet, and we haven't found any kind of agreement. With this kind of preamble, what we are trying to do here today is to attack the three dimensions of the Anthropocene, the past, present, and future, but we don't do it in linear order. Let's start with the present. What do we actually mean by the Anthropocene? How can we characterize the Anthropocene? So one phenomena that some of you might have encountered in your reading is the idea of a great acceleration. And the great acceleration is another one of those vague concepts that sort of indicates that something dramatic has happened over the last several decades in human history. Namely, everything became faster, bigger, more problematic. So if you plot any kind of metric you can think of, whether it's population size, CO2 level in the atmosphere, the number of patents filed by companies, you name it, it all has the shape of a so-called hockey stick graph. So for a long time, nothing much has happened, and over the last couple of decades, it goes into a super exponential growth curve. Now, we're talking about graphs, and we decided not to show any slides, because never, otherwise we wouldn't get anywhere. But that sort of is a segue to ask Geoffrey about what actually do we understand about complex system and their scaling relationships that is responsible for those kind of hockey stick graphs that characterize the Anthropocene?
Well, let's see. First of all, I'm going to violate what you just said and look at the past first, rather than the present. Because I think to understand it in just a few sentences, one first has to contrast what has happened in the Anthropocene, this kind of super exponential hockey stick behavior, with what came before the Anthropocene, and that permeated biology for the last 2-3 billion years. And that is growth, which technically is called sigmoidal, just means bounded growth. You grow quickly and then you stop. That permeates much of biology. And biology also, life in general, over relatively shorter periods of time, is sort of in meta-equilibrium in some way. That is that changes by adaptation and natural selection, evolutionary processes, take very long periods of time, and there's this sort of meta-equilibrium between species and individuals and so on. And much of biology is also dominated in that, in terms of its use of energy, by economies of scale. That is that the bigger you are, the less energy you use per cell or per gram of tissue or whatever. And that goes by the name of, since you brought up superlinear, sublinear scaling. And it is that sublinear scaling which leads to this bounded growth. And bounded growth has built into it, almost obviously in some ways, a certain degree of stability. That is, you spend most of your time in this more stable state. So that has played a central and critical role in the sustainability of life in terms of all its multiple interactions over the last 2-3 billion years. And another characteristic that economy of scale gives rise to is that the pace of life gets slower the bigger you are. So things slow down as things grow and so forth. And as a result of that also is that, and is crucial in this process, is the idea of aging and mortality. Things die so that new things can come, and that's the whole process. And that is to be contrasted with what happened since modern socioeconomic human beings came on the scene, beginning when we started to interact and talk, because one of the things we were able to do was exchange over short periods of time, rather than these long periods of time, information, which allowed us to innovate, create ideas of wealth, increase quality of life, and take advantages over very short periods of time of economies of scale. And so in that sense, using that same language, evolve and adapt over extraordinarily short periods of time. And those are driven by that dynamic, now going to your question, by the structure of our social networks that evolve with our interactions, with our information exchange. That is that, you know, I talk to you, you talk to someone else, they talk to some other person, they talk to me, and we have this kind of positive feedback. So we have this positive feedback mechanism, which gives rise to, instead of economies of scale, the bigger you are, the less per cell, now you have what's called increasing returns. The bigger you are, the more you get. So as things grow, more and more happens, and that leads to this super exponential growth that you're talking about, and that leads to open-ended growth, which is what has dominated mankind, especially in the last couple of hundred years, beginning with the great acceleration following the Industrial Revolution, the discovery of fossil fuels, the exploitation of fossil fuels, and the discovery of capitalism and entrepreneurship and so forth. And that is, I say, driven by information exchange. And just to, you know, I'm sure everybody knows this, that when we transitioned from being hunter-gatherers to sedentary creatures, creating communities and starting this whole process in 10,000 years ago, there were maybe only 5 million people on this planet, which is kind of Phoenix, size of Phoenix. Now there's 7.5 billion people, and there's, you know, several billion coming on board. And in addition, you know, we're one thing that I would like to talk about a little bit later is that, you know, we're growing cities at this extraordinary rate. 1.5 million of us are being urbanized every week. So it's kind of extraordinary. And indeed, if you look at the planet now, as distinct from 10,000 years ago, at night, 10,000 years ago, it looks dark, it's black, you don't even see it. You don't see it, just like you don't see the moon. Now it glows, it's burning. You know, and that's the expression of who we are, and of course the expression of why it's manifestly obvious that the Earth is heating up.
So, as you mentioned, that a lot of it has to do with the way we exchange information, which is basically a consequence of the way our societies have changed and transformed themselves. So, Sander, do you want to take that on and add the social dimension of the Anthropocene?
I want to add, is this thing working? Yeah. I want to add the social dimension, and I want to sort of go a little bit back, not billions of years, but I think actually this whole development of the Anthropocene started at least 2 million years ago. And I want to take with very large steps, sort of point out some of the crucial components of how all of that process happened. And I think the first component is that from, let's say, 2 million years ago to about 50,000 years ago, a lot of the development was both a social and an informational, but predominantly also a biological development. The development of our brain was a slow one, and for a long time it actually limited the number of information sources that we could deal with as individuals. And we can follow that if we follow the whole history of stone tool making. That history, in part, because I'm only taking one window out of it, is the history of how the human mind bent itself around the fact that it was dealing with objects in three dimensions. Because initially, we didn't have any conception how to deal with that. And it took that amount of time for us to begin to distinguish and to show in how we made stone tools that we distinguished three different conceptual dimensions. That's the first step, and that is a step that I think has been very important in our mastery of matter, the very basics of technology, whether it's stone tools or whether it is pottery or other elements. There are differences between those two, but nevertheless, that allowed us as human beings to develop artifacts that became better and better, better focused to the functions that they had, and so forth. Now we get to the phase, let's say, from about 50,000 BC to 10,000 BC. And that is the phase where humans begin to process information collectively. Until then, people walked around the Earth in very, very small groups. And they would very rarely meet and exchange information with other such groups. So what you have is small groups of people who know each other intimately, who develop a way of dealing with life, but it remains there. From about 50,000, what we begin to see is that people come up with a completely different set of artifacts, that they move into environments where they've never been. And the current hypothesis is that that is because the groups grew. And the mechanism behind that is a relatively simple one. It is the relationship between data, information, and knowledge. We observe things, we solve things, we come up with knowledge about that. We have developed tools for thought. Those tools for thought allow us to see other problems. They then allow us to develop new tools for thought. That works fine with a small group, but if you want to go beyond that, you suddenly end up facing problems that you can't solve with that small group anymore. And so we see from that moment an aggregation of larger and larger groups, which have a better and better, in the sense of wider, information processing capacity. And that leads us to the fact that these groups then develop, for example, ways to go and live in the Arctic, which until then people didn't really do. The next step that I want to take is where Geoffrey sort of began in a way, apart from your billions, which is the last 10,000 years, the actual Holocene. Then we see two things. On the one hand, that the human biological constraints of our information processing capacity have reached a point where they can no longer, where there are no longer real constraints. By that point, we can demonstrate again from the stone tool manufacturing that humans can deal with about 7 or 8 sources of information at the same time. You can imagine that by looking at the guy who has balls in the air. He can have about 7 or 8 balls in the air, but if he has more, the chances are that one of them or more of them actually going to fall flat. From that moment on, the combinatorics of having those 7 difficult things that you can combine in your mind in what is called the short-term working memory allow us to start a whole new phase in developing technology, and that led to a whole new phase in the needs of information processing. During the mobile stage, when people were moving around everywhere, the biggest constraint to actually having a good idea together was to find the other person who could share that idea with you, or who could interact with you. So one of the things that information processing and the growth of information processing does, it brings people to the idea that it would all be a lot easier if they all lived more or less in the same place. So we start seeing the building of houses, we start seeing the agglomeration of larger groups in villages, and ultimately we see those villages growing bigger and bigger and becoming urbanized areas. In that whole process, all kinds of other innovations were being made. For example, by the time we get to urban situations, writing, counting, and administration, laws, weights and measures, all those kinds of things that facilitate the interaction between people who don't know each other very well. Well, that to me is sort of the long term of how this Anthropocene evolves. This is the starting point. This is the point that Geoff was talking about, when from a perspective of today, it's all sort of more or less horizontal or begins a little bit to move up. One thing that you need to realize is that in implementing those inventions in society, the biggest effort is not the effort of inventing them. It is the effort that the society collectively makes to actually integrate them in their way of being and in their way of living. And that, I think, explains, to a large extent, the relative stability, at least viewed from us now, because it's very different when you look at it from that period, of how technology evolves and how society evolves. The big difference there, and I come again to the point that Jeff made in a slightly different way, is the fact that with the Industrial Revolution, as we discovered the use of fossil energy, that energy constraint that was limiting the innovativeness of society was falling away. And that, to my mind, is actually where the origins of the Anthropocene, if you absolutely have to define them, which I don't think you should, but that's another story, would actually be defined. Because from that moment, not only is the information processing, because we have large groups of people together, but we also have the energy to actually implement all those innovations in society. So that is where the hockey stick actually really takes off, about 250 years ago. Now, you mentioned very scientific parts of that hockey stick, but one of the interesting parts is also the number of McDonald's hamburgers fits into this same statistic, and many other things of the very daily things that we actually do. So this is an encompassing phenomenon, this Anthropocene, as we, if we call it that way, that actually characterizes our modern world and some of the problems in which we live.
So that's a sort of a very nice segue to bring DA in that conversation, because of course what all those social conditions and the use of energy facilitate is that they open up a space, something that has been recognized before by several thinkers in the beginning of the 20th century, such as Teilhard de Chardin, for instance, who talks about a new sphere, sort of a new sphere of collective consciousness that begins to emerge. So in his case, that was in terms of a Catholic theology. Or people talk about a technosphere, and sort of an independent area where technologies begin to interact. And that's clearly where we are living today in terms of culture, knowledge, technology, and that's basically the world that DA inhabits. So from your point of view, how do you see your world connecting to those stories that we have told here about the origin of the Anthropocene?
Sure. Well, I'd like to start by zooming back 4 trillion years.
And I thought I'd get them to talk about the past later on. Well, anyway, go ahead.
So I will proffer plenty of armchair philosophy tonight, but I've basically been selected off of a street corner and feel like I've won a sweepstakes to be on this stage with these guys. The sort of dumb layman's way in which I view the moment we currently live in is I think of it as a sort of adolescence for humanity. The processes that Jeff and Sander described in such eloquence were essentially a process by which we conquered the planet, and now we live with the benefits of that extreme success, but we're also the victims of our own success. And I analogize it to adolescence because it's as if we're a sort of very strong, mentally disabled baby that is not aware or hasn't been very aware of its own strength, and very easily knock things over, doesn't really understand that the stovetop burns you or how the car works or that you shouldn't leave the garage closed if you turn the car on. And we now find ourselves having moved from an environment that we attributed to God or to the history of nature that we basically didn't understand, to now living in an environment that is both the product of natural history and also human history, and is full of cultural environments that we also barely understand. So it strikes me that we over and over again are now coming to terms with the reality that these environments we've constructed are just as dangerous as the natural environments that we're used to inhabiting. I was watching with my wife an online lecture about ancient Mesopotamia a couple weeks ago, and shit, it sounded terrible. I mean, the stories these folks made up to rationalize the horror of the floods that they were encountering on an annual basis is extremely sad in retrospect. And we today don't really have comparable narratives to situate the challenges that we've created for ourselves. So I'll give you a couple examples of this. One that we were emailing about earlier this week is sort of some of the stuff that's emerged around Facebook and the digital environments we've created that now seemingly are playing a quite significant role in our political processes. And you know, I was one of the first 2,000 users of Facebook. It was a really fun toy and a really great way to check out girls who were at Boston College or whatever else people might have done with it. And we had no idea, including the people who created it, that it could end up disseminating information in sort of uncontrolled and unforeseeable way that it has, obviously with deep consequences. In my world in music, a sort of parallel thing has happened, which is that as the technology we use to create music has shifted into the computer, the most important participants in the artistic process have become the computer programmers who design the software that those of us who write songs use. So I'll give you a very simple example. Pro Tools, which is the software I use to record songs, has a grid system. So time is along a horizontal scrolling axis in its interface, and you record bits of music and you see them visually, and you're defaulted into organizing them in these discrete chunks because the interface has made it so much more obvious to do it that way. If you were just playing a lyre 4,000 years ago or something, you would have never thought to do it that way, which is why when you go and you hear music in India and other places, it's insane. I mean, the structures are unimaginable to us, and to Western ears that have grown up listening to the radio, it's impossible to count or make sense of what's going on. And so what's happened, as I see it, is particularly in media, since both Facebook and Pro Tools are examples of media software, essentially, we have changed the allocation of responsibilities around in a pretty dramatic way, but without a comparable shift in the narratives of identity that allow people participating in the society to understand what they do from a moral and sociocultural and economic point of view. And so we're all sort of driving blind. The job we've been given is a job that we're not even sort of experienced at or fully understanding. And all of us have now been put in the role of media curator and publisher. And these are not things we're trained at. And we used to defer these responsibilities to sort of gatekeeper structures. You know, you didn't have to think about what a good piece of journalism was. You just read the New Yorker or Science or whatever you read. And now it's much more ambiguous. What's credible, who should do what, and who is to blame or to credit for things that work or don't work. And we're just starting to figure out how to navigate this.
So what you're bringing up here, I think, is a very important feature of trying to understand the Anthropocene, also in its current condition, in its development, and in its potential future. And that, I would sort of phrase it as the role of knowledge in all of that. I mean, we have brought up information transfer and what that does from the point of view of biological and even physical systems all the way to social systems. And as Sander was telling us sort of the story about our ancestors trying to figure out how to handle and face and address certain challenges that require the mental capacity to do so, we then have begun to sort of externalize knowledge, which allowed us to share knowledge across distance and integrate and facilitate that combinatorial revolution of both technologies as well as science, for that matter. And now we seem to enter an area that D.A. was talking about, where the, let's call it the embodied or the externalized knowledge in terms of technologies that we create and not even fully understand because they are created by a large sort of global collective and every individual of us just becomes a participant or user of that system. And all of a sudden, those structures begin to determine what we can do and how we live. Is that a particular feature of the Anthropocene? Who wants to take that question?
Yeah, you want to? I can.
Well, I can speculate, I guess. But yes, I think that in answer to your question, is it a particular feature of the Anthropocene as distinct from what's come in the past? Probably in terms of the physical world, that's true. Although, you know, the physical world evolves, you know, the universe, the galaxies, you know, evolve according to deterministic causal equations. I mean, to a great extent anyway, very rational and logical. You know, you could argue that whatever the collective that is giving rise to this, you know, this that it sort of has a life and soul of its own, that at a individual or local level, we no longer can control. So that I assume that's what is almost as if it too has a kind of deterministic feature to it. And indeed, you know, there are, of course, you know, generic regularities that transcend societies and in the past and transcend and exist now. So I'm not so sure that it's unique to us. What I still focus on what we talked about earlier is the fact that we have what is happening, whether it's collective or not, is that this thing has this continuous increasing pace of positive feedback, which makes it grow faster and faster. The bigger it is, the faster it grows. And that, of course, leads to the fundamental question as to whether it is even conceivably sustainable. And just to make it more, even more provocative, whether this, what happened in the last either 10,000 or 250 years, is just some diabolical cosmic joke that, you know, this is a marvelous experiment that just simply can't continue.
There are, of course, plenty of interesting literary figures that say exactly that.
Yeah.
So to what extent would you say that a feature of the Anthropocene, since it seems to be a term that resonates globally, and we will talk about how the Anthropocene actually is looked at differently depending on which part of the globe you are actually at. But has it to do that it sort of captures a certain loss of control of autonomy that we as a society experience? So, Sander.
I think that that certainly is one of the ways in which it manifests itself. He is getting money out of this.
Loss of control.
Okay.
those are our tips.
Yeah. Let me sort of try and put a particular angle on that, whereas I very much agree with what Jeff says, but I've been trying from a societal point of view to look at what might be some of those dynamics. And I'm going to ask you to imagine a budding bureaucracy, and look at it 50 years later. What has happened in that process is that it's become huge. Now, why has it become huge? Every time that in that bureaucracy a problem came up, somebody has tried to solve that problem. And to do that by either putting new rules in place or new people or some other way. But each time that that has happened, that act in itself created new problems. And so what we basically see, and in particular with very large groups of people in the societal domain and in the domain of social control, is that we create more and more of these problems. And so one of the things that I want to at least mention in this context is a mechanism that I think has led us to fundamental societal transitions, but that could also be a very major player in the current sustainability dynamic, and that is that we are, as a society, now faced with the need to try and resolve the results of all the decisions that we took in the past, and in particular, the unanticipated consequences of those decisions. And so when we look at, let's say, from hunter-gatherers to sedentary people, or from village life to urban life, I think one of the dynamics there in each case, which pushes us as a society to a particular tipping point, is the fact that we've done things for a while in a particular way, and in doing that, we have created a whole series of challenges that we now need to start solving. And so I want to very briefly also point out how I think that works. You know, as human beings, as I said, we can handle, let's say, 7 or 8 and collectively more dimensions of problems. So when we see a problem, we see that through a limited number of dimensions. Then we start acting, and in our return to the environment, we touch not only on the dimensions that we've seen, but on the almost infinite dimensions that are also there, that are part of the Earth system dynamic in a wider sense. And one very interesting particularity of this is that what we observe are the things that occur frequently or maybe once a century. So we do things about that. But some of the unintended consequences of our actions may manifest themselves many hundreds of years later. And to oversimplify in the most gross way, poor old Henry Ford, when he invented the first car, he never thought about what would happen if you had more than 3 billion of them. These are the kinds of unintended consequences that I'm talking about.
So, Sander, can I briefly sort of
with problems
jump in here, because one of the questions we have fits right into this dilemma, and it's a question that basically focuses on one of the defining features in living and dealing with the Anthropocene is, given the complexities that we are facing and that you are discussing here, is an issue of trust.
Yeah.
So in those early societies that you described, of course, people knew each other and they had a way of trusting each other that they knew what they were doing might be for the greater good of the community. But how would trust work in those heavily anonymized distributed systems, the world of Facebook and things that that Ye was talking about? So is trust in that sense being a major challenge of the Anthropocene?
Yeah. I very firmly believe so. Okay. But you want to answer that in more detail?
I'll try.
Happy whichever way.
Yeah, it's a timely question, because many of you have probably read about what's happening with Bitcoin and ICOs. Don't put your money into them, is the bottom line. But there's something really interesting happening in that sphere of technology right now, and it is all about engineering out trust, or attempting to engineer out trust. So for the past 20 or 30 years, sort of marginal legal and economic scholars have been thinking about whether you could automate the litigation of law or the processing of financial transactions. We've largely implemented that when it comes to financial transactions. But, you know, when a judge reviews a case and compares the facts of the case to the statute and then makes a decision, you can make the argument that they're essentially doing a rote computation. And whether you believe that or not, there's a strong argument that there's a lot of subjectivity and creativity in that too. But put that aside for the moment. Let's assume it is just a computational task. Why couldn't you automate that? And more importantly, why couldn't you automate that not to a private centralized enterprise like a Facebook or a government, but couldn't you instantiate that sort of processing capability in code and let that code live in a decentralized no man's land, free of all national and sectarian controls? And this is what people are trying to do with Bitcoin and these currencies. They are trying to re-architect the fundamental systems of society on the premise that making them trustless is the goal we should be pursuing. And so when these technologists go on the Bank of America website or the Federal Reserve website or the Supreme Court website and it says a trusted arbiter of the law or whatever, the word trusted is a dirty word to them. Because what it signals to them is that there are individuals who are responsible for implementing the goal. And what they would like to do is see these things completely decentralized and completely automated. Whether that's a vision that we should endorse or not is a very interesting question, but this is at the absolute frontier of mass technology projects right now. And if you're a smart undergrad in computer science and you want to make money, you're either going into AI research or you're going into decentralized currencies right now. And that flow of talent is going to have deep implications for all of us over the next 20, 30 years.
So that sort of brings us into an interesting sort of area of, so if you think about the Anthropocene, the way we looked at it and sort of what the name implies, that it is sort of tied to our species. But what we are beginning to see here is that what might become in the very near future already has become a much more active ingredient is not just what we think we do or what we think our agency is, but it's the agency of those engineered systems. So that brings us, as in a way, to what future trajectory are we envision here? And that, in a way, explains why this panel is sort of at the end of a whole weekend of activities of the InterPlanetary Project, where we are trying to sort of envision potential futures that go way beyond the imagination by saying what would actually happen if you look at our planet from a broader perspective. And so in that sense, how can we look at the Anthropocene and understanding our current historical situation from the point of view of a realistic future technological scenario? Does anybody want to take that one?
Go on. I think you're the one who's the only one who might be able to do it. I think you started it.
You might as well continue.
Exactly.
I'm happy to say something.
Yeah, but
okay, I mean, I'll say one more thing. Since you asked, since this is a Santa Fe Institute event, I will invoke the concept of emergent behaviors. Mm-hmm. And as I understand sophisticated questions in physics, there is a set of interesting things to think about with respect to how time works and why time has its directionality and so forth. And I think there's an error, a minor error maybe, or missing the forest for the trees issue among physicists who I talked to about this, in that if you make the argument that there is no teleology to history, that the reason time moves in the direction it does is because we had a low entropy past, and it is essentially iconological and emergent and whatever, I think you miss out on what I would characterize as emergent teleologies that we are all born into. And I think the kind of folk terminology for them is tradition, that we're all born into a world in which a number of long-term processes are unfolding. And you can think of our arrival in the context of these processes as a sort of invitation to either disband the party and give them up, or try to dismantle them, or to take them to their logical conclusion. And so it strikes me that whether you make it exciting by talking about the AI revolution and automation and robots or whatever, we're basically just continuing the Enlightenment, basically just continuing Taylorism and Fordism. And we have to decide now, it's become a sort of a resting question to people recently, whether we want to fully explore those visions of the future. So in my world in Silicon Valley, basically there is a consensus that it's a great idea, that we should automate as much as everything. The next, you know, jobs to go are service jobs, information jobs, but that there's really no necessary end to this, and that what we ought to do is prioritize that and then re-architect social norms and societal institutions around it through things like a basic income or other fundamentally different resource allocation strategies. And it doesn't strike me that that is the only choice we have or inevitable. And I think some of the language that we're trapped in almost makes the only way that we can talk about our present to be to talk about the future. And so we have an impoverished vocabulary for talking about the present. And I think at our present, we get to choose whether we continue these technological teleologies or not.
So sort of summarizing some of the comments we have here and sort of bringing up another dimension of the whole question about the Anthropocene. So we have been talking here from a very Western scientific point of view, and then very quickly moved into our technological area. But what's interesting about the debate about the Anthropocene, if you follow it, and we did a study about that, how it diffused over the last 15 years, that it matters greatly where you are on this planet as to what your perspective on the Anthropocene is. So we sit here and we are close to the Santa Fe Institute, connections to Silicon Valley. Of course, we are interested in technology, technosphere, the internet, artificial intelligence, and all those things. But that's not the way somebody in Africa or somebody in Southeast Asia or even in China views the Anthropocene. So, Sander, you have traveled the world over the last year and a half and have experienced a lot of different perspectives in the context also of sustainability, but also about different perspectives about our current planetary epoch. Can you sort of enlighten us a little bit on that?
I will try. First thing to say is that I think it's important to realize that our ways of thinking are not defined by what we know and we think about, but they are limited by those questions we have never asked. The total unknown that is outside our tradition, that is outside our culture. And it is that that I've been getting involved in over the last few years, working in China and Japan, but more recently also experiencing this at a very interesting first conference in which African nations tried to word, with lots of difficulty, how they actually see their future and what their problems are. And so my sense is two things: the diversity of cultures and the fact that we are, for the moment, particularly the United Nations with its sustainable development goals, is trying to push in a particular direction, but that that direction is very, very heavily biased by Western culture. Not that all these nations didn't agree to it, but it was the elites who all had their education in particular universities in this country or in Britain or in Australia and in France. So there has been created a sort of semblance of a global possibility of a global future. And I think that is something that is not realistic, if I am perfectly clear from my own perspective, and that we need to start beginning to take into account. That gets me to your remark about the Silicon Valley approach. In putting primacy on the technological development and then adapting society through, let's say, a standard salary or wage, I think we're doing something that very few people in the end can accept. And that is the fact that we are creating a value system that has very few dimensions. Globalization has been a very large part of that, because what has it done? It has made GDP, wealth, money as the yardstick by which not only nations but also individuals compare each other. That is a development that started in the 1830s, 1850s in Britain, when there was a very interesting and generally unobserved twist to the balance between the economy and the society. Up to that moment, and in many other societies in the present, the economy serves the society. From that moment on, certain anthropologists argue that it turned the other way around, and that society began to serve the economy. That is something that I encounter meeting people in Africa, meeting people in the Near East, and in other parts of the world, in particular in the Far East, where I am now working. So I would argue that this should also make us wonder about whether our development is actually the way forward, or whether we should think about other ways. And then we think about this whole concept of future, and I would argue that the only way to go into that future is to conceive of many futures and basically experiment.
Yeah. So I think following on that, and also sort of summarizing some of the questions that have to do with the way that panel has been sort of popularized in the media, that the Anthropocene discussion is often tied to major threats to our sustainability, and the question of the sixth mass extinction, and are we basically heading towards doomsday? So questions from the audience focus on what, given our understanding of those systems dynamics, might actually be some of the most serious threats that we can anticipate, again, sort of thinking about futures. And secondly, what is our moral responsibility as scientists to address this and inform the public? Now, Jeff, you were just now very active in New Mexico trying to prevent the going backwards on the science standards. So do you want to take on those two questions? So thank Jeff for that.
Well, no, I was not very active. I did certainly participate, but I wouldn't say I was very active. But that is actually a very interesting metric or indicator of some of the big issues that we have to face. In terms of the whole relationship of science and technology to society. And I'm going to take several threads here. One is going from what DA said and casting our way of thinking into the future almost entirely in when we think of new things, innovating and so on, in very physical terms, which is pretty much the traditional way of thinking of innovations, whatever they are, you know, whether we started thinking about, you know, discovering iron or everywhere to inventing IT and computers. These are very physical, and that's the way Silicon Valley is thinking about it. And I think what Sander is bringing up is a complement to that in terms of, I will change the language a little bit. Sure. What we need to be thinking of are cultural innovations. Yeah. Because I think one of the big issues which has been faced in the last 250 years, but has come up again, is alienation, the whole idea of people being alienated by this, both in terms of feeling left out, feeling soulless. We feel that in this country, and no doubt some of our politics is governed by that. But China has a huge issue in terms of transitioning people from living essentially 19th century agricultural lives to high tech. And they do that by urbanizing at this extraordinary rate of 200 to 300 new cities in the next 15 to 20 years, all of which are kind of soulless places. So this is actually a global issue in terms of what are the kinds of cultural changes we need. And I was very much in agreement with your bringing to consciousness the idea that we judge our success also in physical terms, like using, but economic in this instance, mm-hmm. by using the GDP.
Yeah.
And whimsically, I've suggested recently, and I'm certainly not unique in this, that it would be great on the news in the evening, instead of always having just the GDP, there's a kind of happiness index or quality of life index that goes along with it, so that we see that the quality of life index went down last week when the Dow Jones average went up because there were fires in California, and there were killings in Las Vegas and so on. So that's at some sort of whimsical level, but in fact, to think seriously about, is that something that we could imagine happening? And that also goes to your earlier question of this whole technological phenomenon that has engulfed us. If it does have a life of its own, if it has its own internal dynamic, can we in fact in any way intervene in that? What kind of intervention can we imagine doing to change it from this kind of harsh technological society seen that way to something that's more humanistic, that is more concerned with love rather than, what's the next, what's going to happen to the iPhone 9? What's that going to do to my life?
We skipped over that.
Yeah, we probably did.
Yeah, we have 8 to 10. We haven't got 9.
It's coming.
Just a detail, maybe.
So I think that's the kind of issue that is extraordinarily difficult to grapple with. And whether that is, whether we can, in fact, in any way affect the collective process, which after all, in the end, is some convolution between the dynamic that is driven at the moment by kind of, quote, Silicon Valley as a proxy for the whole technological society and the political process.
So that, again, sort of following up on several of the comments that you make, and thanks, by the way, for being so active. This is really great. makes my job that much easier here. So there is a concern as to what extent where we are in our moment that has a particular technological trajectory that causes and is correlated to certain fears about degrading our environment and cutting off the resources of that planet, and trying to find a way, given all those dynamics, to regulate and control those. So where can we imagine that regulatory mechanisms could come in the present or in the future that might actually allow us to rein in those dynamics and correct course? Or alternatively, are we basically on a course to run into a wall where some cataclysmic event needs to happen and whoever is left needs to pick up the pieces. So those might be some scenarios. So let's be on the optimistic side and try to imagine where we could find interventions and regulatory control mechanisms that might actually characterize and introduce a new systems dynamic. So, yeah, you talked about some of them already. So, may I explore that further?
Sure. I would just second everything you guys said about prioritizing a broader basket of humanistic goals beyond just economic development, which has become the singular focus of most developing economies for the past 100 years, and it's sort of a wrong turn that has now produced some seriously obvious negative consequences. And I think we, just as we have inherited all sorts of in-process technological trends, we've also inherited lots of humanistic projects that are worth continuing. So just as we're finding ourselves in the middle of a hundreds of years long industrial revolution, we're also finding ourselves in the middle of an abolitionist revolution, the goal of which is to essentially release people from systems of bondage and to enable them to flourish in ways that realize all of their human capabilities. And so, you know, it's not as if we completely fail to imagine mechanisms or economic or governmental technologies that can rein in our excesses or our worst temptations. The reason we don't have child labor for the most part in the United States is because we have laws against it. And we have institutions with rich histories, the purpose of which is to rein in those kind of behaviors. And so, to our economic detriment. I mean, we would have a higher GDP if 14-year-olds were knitting sneakers here. So the tools are there to a certain degree. It's a matter of emphasis. And one of the sort of interesting questions, I think, in the context of thinking about these technological dynamics that may or may not be controllable, is that there is a sort of prophetic viewpoint that pops up every once in a while in history through people like Gandhi or Martin Luther King that calls to our attention the reality that we all get to decide what we work on when we wake up every morning. Mm-hmm. And we can choose to go and build a crazy machine for distributing misinformation in an insane way. And you can get paid to do that. You can also get up and work to increase access to the basic goods of a flourishing human life for people. And there are people who do that every day. And so to me, it's a matter of inflection. That's where culture is very important because, to Sander's point, what has become sort of necrotic is the culture that invests meaning and social respectability in the people who do the work that is actually most important. And the work that, when we look back on other people who have done similar work, constitutes our proudest achievements as a civilization. I mean, none of us are, you know, getting teary-eyed watching montages on television of steam engines.
Some people do.
Sorry, I didn't
wrong
mean
crowd.
To take that away.
I forgot my audience. But, you know, but when you see these sort of incredible examples of human resiliency and courage and justice, that's what really makes us proud. And yet we don't have a culture right now that validates that kind of work in a broad way. And that's a real problem.
Mm-hmm. So thanks for that.
Right crowd, okay, good.
Enthusiasm of the young.
I'll be jaded in 10 years, don't worry.
Well, so, what we, you know, what we, I mean, going on from what you said, what we really need is, you know, it's interesting. You mentioned, you know, the Gandhis, the Martin Luther Kings, and so on. And these people somehow are able to capture, to encapsulate something that we all feel, the better part of our nature. And I venture into dangerous territory here, but in contrast to other people who are also able to do that,
yeah,
and have been extraordinary. It's a kind of genius, and our president seems to be one of those people who's been able to tap in to what I speak totally from my own personal viewpoint, some of the worst aspects of our collective behavior and exploit them in many ways. And so, you know, so it's an interesting question, which is outside of my expertise for sure, and that is that in order to effect change and to reverse this mad rush towards purely technological kinds of ways of viewing things, and to balance that with more humanistic ways of countering it, and to get a different way of gauging the success, in quotes, of our society, we sort of need an anti-Trump. We need someone that is that has all those characteristics that Trump had, in able to tap in to the dark side of certainly the American population, to tap in to this other part, which is our moral conscience and our humanism and our love. And you know, one of the sad things, I think, is that we haven't seen any such leadership suddenly in my lifetime.
Bernie.
Who? So it's...
Can I add an element
to that? And it's interesting, and I don't know whether that's... Is that a necessary piece in order to counter this?
I think that's one necessary piece. I would argue that we also suffer from the fact that as part of globalization and the reduction of the complexity of our value systems, we have actually broken down, and it may be reconstructed, I don't know, but we have for the moment broken down many senses of community. Oh, let me finish before you applaud, okay? I'm not sure about this. But one of the things that strikes me is that the fact that we've broken that down puts everybody as an individual up front. Now, there are very interesting pieces of research about social innovation, which basically say you need about 10% of a community to actually make a real change. I think one of the things that we are missing is the sense of community. Human beings need two things emotionally. They need a sense of belonging, and they need a sense of being the exception. In order to bring those two things together, you need a very wide set of values for a society. Because that way, people can identify with it, but they can always claim that in one or two of those dimensions, they are the exception. Look, I have seen this in Papua New Guinea, okay? I'm not talking out of the top of my head. And so I think one of the things that we need to really do also is to rebuild different kinds of communities. And I sense this very strongly in another place where I live, in France, where the southern part of the country still has maintained that sense of community. The northern part of the country, it has been eroded away. And I think that is actually one of the fundamental dilemmas of French politics. Because that means that the sort of modern way of globalized, or whatever you would call it, sort of economy, meets with a resistance that you don't meet in other places. And I think that is justified. If I look at my experience in Africa or New Guinea or China, what I see is that that sense of community is one of the best ways to create resilience against all kinds of things. Japan is another fantastic example. In Japan, when there is an economic change, people don't consider the economy. They consider that maintaining the community is actually the only way in which they'll survive. Now, that's not so surprising if you live in a country where an earthquake can happen anytime, or a big flood, and you actually need to deal with those collectively. So on the one hand, I'm arguing that. The other hand, what I'm saying is that I think to find one solution is not going to work. We've tried that. The United Nations has tried that for CO2 and things like that. We need to not only begin to look at biodiversity, we need to foster cultural diversity. We need, in that sense, to have the respect, but also the will, to get that those communities to manifest themselves, to have their own way. In that sense, I am very much an adept of Elinor Ostrom's multipolar world, which I think is much more realistic than where we're going right now.
So, this is an SFI event, so we have engaged with your help in sort of really trying to imagine a whole number of challenges and future scenarios and brought up important perspectives. So maybe in a final round, let's try to sort of step back and go to our role as scientists and take what several of you also wrote as a challenge to us. What is the responsibility and what of the scientists, and what can be the contributions of the scientists to really addressing those kind of challenges that we all discussed here. So what can we actually contribute as scientists focusing on complex systems to the understanding of those challenges and problems? Geoffrey.
Well, first, part of it is represented by the Sander Institute itself, because this problem is one that is the problem of the future of the planet, the future of human beings and the form that we've evolved in our socioeconomic success and all the problems that it's created that we've sort of alluded to. This is the quintessential so-called complex adaptive system. It involves multiple disciplines. Every possible discipline, every possible viewpoint needs to be brought together to address this question. Everything from mathematics and physics through all the biological, biomedical sciences to the social sciences and so forth. And maybe I'm preaching to the choir, but the way that our academic structure has evolved is to divvy everything up into this stovepipe way, and the Sander Institute was founded in order to bring these things together and break down the boundaries and see the great synergisms and cross the great divides between them. So the Sander Institute is maybe the only place, as far as I can tell, that seriously does this on the planet. Every university says it's trying to do it, wants to do it, this is what its future is, but the reality is almost very little of it takes place. Arizona State, by the way, your university, is one of the few places that where Michael Crow, the president, has tried to take a serious whack at making this work. To make it really, to really address this problem, we need a multi-billion, I don't know, trillion-dollar program that's international.
Come on, that's self-serving, because you always ask for more money. But
that would make the Apollo program or the Manhattan Project look like some small little program. And because the problem that we face, I believe, makes, for example, the problems that we had to address in the Second World War small in terms of the future of humanity. And if we don't come to that realization, regardless of what one thinks about what the future actually will be, I think we're in extremely dire straits. So we need, that goes again to that leadership question. Who is the leader that's going to do it? Because fundamentally, it's a political question as to whether one can get that kind of funding and to make it international and to start more and more to coerce scientists to think more globally, to think more transdisciplinary, and so on. And that, of course, requires a revolution. So I think that if you ask what should a scientist do, that scientist should become part of the Sanofi Institute community to begin with and work towards this end. And
I can wholeheartedly agree with that. So practically, DA, so you told us before that sort of you moved more or less from your career in music to almost full-time investing, but not just investing for investing's sake, but investing to actually identify those future technologies, companies that can make a difference in that. So from your point of view, are you hopeful? And what are the challenges? And is there enough for you to invest in out there? Or what would you like to see?
Yes. I'm very hopeful. It's obvious that the leader you described, Jeff, is here. And it's David Krakauer. He's going to raise $1 trillion and make complexity research ever present. But a lot of the work that I do is downstream of the science, and it involves taking scientific discoveries or engineering breakthroughs and productizing them for the rest of us. And that's where the rubber hits the road when it comes to this type of stuff, which is why I find it interesting. I think there are two sides to the challenge that I perceive. One is that we have to keep, as lay people, creating commercial structures that incentivize scientists and engineers to build businesses, because I think their businesses tend to be the more interesting ones and the ones that have the greatest impact long term in certain ways. And right now, what I perceive as an investor is that there is no shortage of great science out there that could be commercialized. What there is a desperate lack of commercial infrastructure to translate it. The other part of the project involves the rest of us, and it's essentially cultural. And in some of the areas where I'm operating around bioengineering in particular, not only is it a struggle to get the science from the bench to the bedside, as it were, but there are seriously difficult cultural headwinds that innovators face when it comes to engineering-oriented solutions for global problems. And I attribute this to some wrong turns that the environmental movement took in the past 50 years, wherein engineering became a dirty word. And we created some mythical conception of a natural, idyllic past to which we should be returning. The reality is, we've gotten ourselves in this mess. The only way we're going to get ourselves out of it, or just keep the mess only as messy as it is through making more messes. As Sander put it, every solution begets new problems, but that's just what we have to deal with. And when it comes to things like genetic modification, geoengineering for the purposes of climate control, and so forth, it's important that we have a literate public that does not have a phobic attitude to these types of technologies. If the smart, good liberal sweethearts think that genetically modified anything is dangerous, we're done. It's stupid. I mean, it's stupid, it's irrational, and it's holding us back. And so those of us who are operating in the cultural domain have to find new narratives to make sense of some of these technologies. Otherwise, society is going to stop them. I mean, you can't study embryos at a particular moment in their development because the law prevents it for arbitrary religious misconceptions.
So following up on that, so would the idea that we actually, the whole concept of the Anthropocene as a new geological era that is dominated by man, could there be a cultural transformation, sort of a new cultural narrative, that if we accept the Anthropocene and our responsibilities in the Anthropocene as a major actor, actually lead to a more positive narrative for the kind of technologies that you identified as being necessary to actually survive?
I mean, absolutely. Like this, the Anthropocene is our greatest accomplishment. So we should be psyched about it. And we got to keep, I mean, the opposite of the Anthropocene is we are extinct. So unless you want that future, we're going to keep rocking with the Anthropocene and figure out new ways of delivering more responsibly.
Again.
Well, hmm? For example.
But so, we could be,
So this was a good provocation because one of Sander's projects, he's actually involved in a big international project called The World in 2050 that tries to imagine futures. So Sander, can that be one of the narratives that might be useful?
I think there's going to be a lot of narratives. I think both the opinions that I've heard, although the trillion to me is a bit out of reach, but I know what you mean. I think they are relevant.
Sander,
no, I know, but I want to start thinking big in a different way.
Yeah.
That's why I'm raising that. I would argue that maybe all of this is not going to come from science. I would argue that science sometimes is very immodest and doesn't have the humility to relate itself to what is going on in society in a wider sense. I think we are going to get the kind of changes societally that we're talking about. And the reason why I'm saying that is because with my 2 million years perspective, I have the huge advantage to have seen that humanity every time has found a way to solve some of these problems, but in the nick of time. And that it has been driven bottom up rather than top down. And so my feeling is that we can help as scientists to move this forward, but we should not in any way claim that we could be leading it. I think that is an important point that I want to make. The other,
Yeah, but I was just sort of that, I can sort of make a connection and also sort of tie this panel to the whole weekend of events. I think that is part of the reason why in the interplanetary project here at the Santa Fe Institute, there's this very active dialogue between science and the arts and creativity that would actually get, you know, not just a unique scientific perspective, but we need creativity wherever we can find it. But the important thing is to create an environment where this dialogue can take place.
Yeah. So. I'll leave it at that. I think those are good final words.
Okay. So since I get signals that we are running over our allotted time,
it's okay.
Let me sort of thank the panelists for some very exciting statements and contributions. And let me also thank the audience for actually participating in our experiment here. So I think this was really great. I'm sorry that we didn't get to all of your questions, but I tried to sort of package them and feed them into the discussions here. And I think we probably got more of you than if we would have gone on and then had 5 minutes at the end with a random selection of 3 or 4 of you to ask a question. So with this, let's thank everybody again. And remember, November 7th is the final event in the community series. Thank you.
Manfred's good at this. I've never heard it.